محمد وآل محمد صلوات. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. سورة الواقعة. This is سورة number 56. الواقعة. One of the ayahs has, I think ayah number 8 is there in this book, which has numerous translations. And hence I just picked this one. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا وقعت الواقعة ليس لوقعتها كاذبة خافضة رافعة إذا رجت الأرض رجا وبست الجبال بسا فكانت هباء منبثا وكنتم أزواجا ثلاثا فأصحاب الميمنة ما أصحاب الميمنة وأصحاب المشأمة ما أصحاب المشأمة والسابقون السابقون أولئك المقربون في جنات النعيم ثلة من الأولين وقليل من الآخرين على سرر موضونة متكئين عليها متقابلين يطوف عليهم ولدان مخلدون بأكواب وأباريق وكأس من معين لا يصدعون عنها ولا ينزفون وفاكهة مما يتخيرون ولحم طير مما يشتهون وحور عين كأمثال اللؤلؤ المكنون جزاء بما كانوا يعملون لا يسمعون فيها لغوا ولا تأثيما إلا قيلا سلاما سلاما وأصحاب اليمين ما أصحاب اليمين في سدر مخضود وطلح منضود وظل ممدود وماء مسكوب وفاكهة كثيرة لا مقطوعة ولا ممنوعة وفرش مرفوعة إنا أنشأناهن إنشاء فجعلناهن أبكارا عربا أترابا لأصحاب اليمين ثلة من الأولين وثلة من الآخرين وأصحاب الشمال ما أصحاب الشمال في سموم وحميم وظل من يحموم لا بارد ولا كريم إنهم كانوا قبل ذلك مترفين وكانوا يصرون على الحنث العظيم وكانوا يقولون أئذا متنا وكنا ترابا وعظاما أئنا لمبعوثون أو آباؤنا الأولون قل إن الأولين والآخرين لمجموعون إلى ميقات يوم معلوم ثم إنكم أيها الضالون المكذبون لآكلون من شجر من زقوم فمالئون منها البطون فشاربون عليه من الحميم فشاربون شرب الهيم هذا نزلهم يوم الدين نحن خلقناكم فلولا تصدقون أفرأيتم ما تمنون أأنتم تخلقونه أم نحن الخالقون نحن قدرنا بينكم الموت وما نحن بمسبوقين على أن نبدل أمثالكم وننشئكم فيما لا تعلمون ولقد علمتم النشأة الأولى فلولا تذكرون أفرأيتم ما تحرثون أأنتم تزرعونه أم نحن الزارعون لو نشاء لجعلناه حطاما فظلتم تفكهون إنا لمغرمون بل نحن محرومون أفرأيتم الماء الذي تشربون أأنتم أنزلتموه من المزن أم نحن المنزلون لو نشاء جعلناه أجاجا فلولا تشكرون أفرأيتم النار التي تورون أأنتم أنشأتم شجرتها أم نحن المنشئون نحن جعلناها تذكرة ومتاعا للمقوين فسبح باسم ربك العظيم فلا أقسم بمواقع النجوم وإنه لقسم لو تعلمون عظيم إنه لقرآن كريم في كتاب مكنون لا يمسه إلا المطهرون تنزيل من رب العالمين أفبهذا الحديث أنتم مدهنون وتجعلون رزقكم أنكم تكذبون فلولا إذا بلغت الحلقوم وأنتم حينئذ تنظرون ونحن أقرب إليه منكم ولكن لا تبصرون فلولا إن كنتم غير مدينين ترجعونها إن كنتم صادقين فأما إن كان من المقربين فروح وريحان وجنة نعيم وأما إن كان من أصحاب اليمين فسلام لك من أصحاب اليمين وأما إن كان من المكذبين الضالين فنزل من حميم وتصلية جحيم إن هذا لهو الحق اليقين فسبح باسم ربك العظيم آمنا بالله وصدق الله العلي العظيم صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى سورة البركة الفاتحة
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن السلام عليكم ورحمة الله The speaker is just coming because he realized that he has not said Asr Salat so he's just finishing now he's just asking inshallah Allahumma salli ala Muhammad Bismillah. Fadl. Fadl, fadl. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المنتجبين اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله الحمد لله all praise belongs to Allah سبحانه وتعالى for this wonderful opportunity to arrange this exhibition which we believe is first of its kind in Canada. We have done some research and found that past exhibitions have to do with calligraphy. This is the first time that we have collected translations of Quran. You'll see there is a booklet which we have published with this exhibition. Make sure you have your copy. The title is A Probe into English Translations of Quran. And it has a complete list of 112 translators since 1649 to now. And we have been able to collect about 50 translations we have kept on display. Besides that, we also have some articles, academic articles, whereby, in fact, the scholars themselves also have written that it is not an easy thing. Quran has defied, in fact, translation. Today's topic, in fact, is very much relevant, commonly mistranslated verses. In fact, this booklet also has 40 such verses, the list of which was provided by Dr. Mustafa Khattab, so he's the right person to address. About his profile, about his bio, it is already online. I'm not going to repeat myself, except that my personal interaction with him, he is really a true scholar of Quran, because every time I have emailed him, I texted him that I want certain things, immediately response. Even we wanted to make a small video clip for this exhibition. We requested him, please make a small short video clip. He did that in spite of being very busy in the month of Ramadan. So we are really pleased to have him here. Inshallah, he will share with us his experience. But before I let you go, make sure that you please talk to your contacts. We have got a lot of flyers. People still are not aware. Take these flyers, try to distribute with your friends, with your colleagues, your neighbors. These sessions are open for all Canadians. So do in fact invite them. We have got postcards also. And make sure that you sign the book, visitor's book, and also get a copy for yourself, A Probe into English Quran Translations. Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man walah. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower his blessings on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his family. Ameen, ameen. So today, inshallah, I'm here to talk about some commonly mistranslated verses of the Quran. I'm going to begin with a short story. There was a friend of mine from Egypt. His family, basically everyone in the family was a farmer. So, and this goes back like hundreds of years. He was the first educated person in the history of his family. And the only reason he got an education is because of his mother. She fought for him to get an education. So he studied at Al-Azhar for so many years. He studied in Arabic. Then when he graduated high school, and mashallah his grades were high, he went to study Islam in English. There was only one problem. His English was in the basement. Terrible English. And the reason is, in high school, they don't have the best English teachers because some of them, or actually most of them, they didn't actually study English. They studied math, they studied science, they studied physical exercise, whatever, and they came to teach English. And this is why his English was horrible. Every time he gave a talk, his friends used to make fun of him and his teachers would ask him to shut up. So at some point, he felt very bad, this brother, and he decided to do something about it. And he said, you know what, I have some of the top you know, students in the class, if I talk to them in English, this maybe will help me improve my level of spoken English. So he picked one of them, Brother Muhammad, one of the top students in the class at Al-Azhar in Islamic Studies in English. And he said, if I talk to this brother on a daily basis, this inshallah would help me a great deal. So he said, Brother Muhammad, can we speak in English? Because this will help me. So Brother Muhammad said, your English is so bad. If I talk to you in English, this is going to spoil my English. Thank you. Thanks for coming. Shut the door. Bye-bye. So that day, this brother felt very offended. He felt so sorry for himself. Am I that bad? That was the thought. In the village culture in Egypt, we have this saying, if you get a kick from behind, it shouldn't make you fall down, it should push you forward. So I believe that brother, that day, he got the biggest kick of his life. So that night, after he prayed Isha, he prayed Witr, and he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, Ya Allah, Anta Rabbul Alameen, you are the Lord of the heavens and the earth. You created the sun and the moon and the stars and the galaxies. It is not difficult for you to help me speak good English. And I make a pledge to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Nadr, if my English gets better, I'm going to use it for da'wah to invite people to Islam. Then this brother started to learn and read novels and stories, Shakespeare and different stories. And every night he would sleep with the BBC in his ears. It's 10 p.m. and this is the news. Ah, this is how they speak British English. Terrifying. And the brother was working hard for 3 years. Alhamdulillah, after 3 years, he graduated. And he was the top, not only of his class, he was the top of the entire English department. They have simultaneous translation, literature, and Islamic studies. And he was the top student in the entire department and the second student in the entire school. And within 2 to 3 months, he was appointed as a professor at that department. And the irony is, Brother Muhammad, who 3 years earlier had refused to speak to this brother, actually failed in the last year. And this is what happens when you feel like you reached a point where there's nothing to improve, you are perfect, there's nothing else to do, you start going down. So there's always room for improvement. This brother, alhamdulillah, he worked at Al-Azhar Islamic Studies in English as a professor for over 10, 12 years. Then eventually he moved to the U.S. after he received his bachelor's, his master's, his PhD from Al-Azhar in Islamic Studies and English with honors. And for the last 10, 11 years has been doing da'wah. And alhamdulillah, he has given shahada to hundreds of people. And alhamdulillah, he produced, I know this brother personally, he produced a good translation of the Quran. When he was born 40 years ago, I was there for his birth. When he got married 11 years ago, I was there for his wedding. And every morning when I look at the mirror, I see this brother because this is my story. I'm talking about myself. Just wanted to put some suspense in there. So based on my life story and how I learned English, there's nothing impossible in this world. If you put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you work hard, then you will be able to achieve something. The only one who can stop you from succeeding or achieving something is actually you. At least you have to put the effort and put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you want to learn Arabic, Farsi, Urdu, whatever language, you'll be able to, inshallah, with the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about the clear Quran before I talk about the mistranslations. In 2015, we completed the translation of the Quran and the proof copy came out. And many copies were sold, and we're receiving feedback. And for the last 2 years, alhamdulillah, I've been doing a lot of improvements to the translation. But as of January of this year, alhamdulillah, the Clear Quran is the bestseller on Amazon when it comes to the Kindle edition. It is the number one translation in Canada. We're doing the same thing in the U.S. Every year, they give out more than 500,000 copies. Sponsored by Masajid, and they give them out for da'wah at open houses and so on and so forth. And in Canada here, we sell about 10,000 copies every year. So alhamdulillah, people accept the translation and they like it. But there is a story behind this translation. A few years ago, I was in Toronto. I came from Edmonton to serve as an imam for 1 month at the masjid downtown Toronto on Dundas. And I told you I came from the village. I'm a farmer, a simple guy, not that complicated. So I stayed there for 1 month. And during that month, I didn't like it in Toronto. They didn't have Islamic schools. I love soccer. I love to play soccer. There's no place to play. There's no place to take my family out. I feel like pretty much like Yunus alayhi salam when he was in the belly of the whale, lost. So after 1 month, they made the announcement, the president, Sheikh Atiyah, said, "We welcome the new imam to the community." And I said, "No, the former imam. I'm leaving. I'm not staying. What am I, a sucker or something? I have to leave." So alhamdulillah, now I'm in Mississauga. I like it. It has a village feel and it has a city feel. But during my stay in Toronto, I didn't have a car at the time because I was staying for a short period and there was no place to park the car. So every time they called a cab driver to come and give me a ride to the masjid and back to the hotel. And if you know Toronto, most of the cab drivers, at least from my own experience, most of the cab drivers in Toronto are Muslim, right? Alhamdulillah. So that particular day, close to the end of my stay in Toronto, the cab driver was not Muslim. Not a problem. So out of nowhere, he said, "You know what? Muslims are good people, but Islam sucks." These are his own words. And I said, "Okay, thanks for the compliment about Muslims, but why do you think Islam is bad?" And he said, "You know what? Because your religion calls me an animal." And I said, "Where is that?" He said, "It's in the Quran, chapter 8, verse 55. إِنَّ شَرَّ الدَّوَابِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ عَاهَدْتَ مِنْهُمْ ثُمَّ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَهُمْ." And I said, "But, you know, in context, the ayah talks about those who were living at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca, or when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam moved to Medina, they made peace agreements and they violated them all the time. And plus the ayah does not say animal, it says dabba. And the word dabba in the Arabic language is a very general word. What is the proof? If you go to Surah Nur, Surah An-Nur, Surah 24, ayah 45. وَاللَّهُ خَلَقَ كُلَّ دَابَّةٍ مِمَّا فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى بَطْنِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى رِجْلَيْنِ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَمْشِي عَلَى أَرْبَعٍ. It says, Surah 24, Ayah 45, Allah created every living being from water. Some of them slither on their bellies like snakes, some walk on 2 feet like humans, and some walk on 4 like a cat or a goat. So it's a very general term. He says, "No, this is what his translation said, and that's it. I'm an animal." I said, "Okay, whatever you want." So that night, I went to my hotel room and I checked. There's this website, it's called islamawakened.com/Quran. islamawakened.com/Quran. And for every ayah of the Quran, they give you about 45, 47 different translations of the same ayah. And I realized the man was right. Most of them said either animal or beast, which is even worse. The correct translation is a living being or a moving creature. So I decided to do a translation, and alhamdulillah, this is how the Clear Quran came about. It's the result of collaboration between more than 75 scholars, and Muslims and non-Muslims, men and women, old, young, and actually most of the team were sisters, because it's 2017, as Trudeau says. So alhamdulillah, the sisters were so dedicated, and alhamdulillah, we did so many revisions, about 10 of them. And at least in two of them, someone, the chief editor, Brother Abu Isa Webb, would read out the translation out loud, and people would listen to the translation, and they say, "Okay, this is smooth. We need to smooth this one out." And this is why one good aspect about this translation is the flow. It has a very good flow to it. And I'm going to give you an example at the end. You see the rhymes and the rhythm. We didn't twist the ayat to make it rhyme, but if it rhymed, alhamdulillah. If not, then khalas, we move on. So the Clear Quran is technically the first translation of the Quran in English ever completed and published in Canada. And alhamdulillah, some people give me another credit. I don't deserve it. They say I'm the youngest person ever to translate the Quran in English. It is not very accurate because I did another one 12 years ago. So I was even younger. The other translation we did, it was for the Taraweeh from Mecca and Medina. Till this day, if you watch Taraweeh live from Mecca and Medina, you see the subtitles. I was a member of the first team that did the translation. I was not totally happy with it. We did it in a short period of time, but alhamdulillah, I took my time with my team and we did this fantastic translation. Now, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about the Quran? لا ريب فيه, there is no doubt in this Quran or about it that the fact that it came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number two, there is no contradiction in it. وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. However, some, especially non-Muslims, like people like Robert Spencer, Tariq Fattah, if you know him, and Ayan Hirshi Ali, I call them idiots, I don't know what you call them, but anyway, they always come up with contradictions in the Quran in the form of translation. And we keep telling them the translation is not the Quran. The translation is a tafsir in English, just like Ibn Kathir, Jalalain, other tafsir in Arabic. So the translation is my work. The Arabic is the work of Allah. So if there is any contradiction, look in the Arabic, don't look in the English, because a translator is a human being, and everyone who translated the Quran were human beings, and we make mistakes. We translate based on the best of our understanding of the divine revelation. If there is any problem in the English, don't blame Allah, blame me, right? But they take something out of context, or they find a contradiction because the translator made a mistake in the translation. I'm going to give some examples. The other thing is the Quran is perfectly consistent. So I'm going to digress a little bit here. Why does the Quran talk about Musa alayhi salam almost like all over the place? 50 surahs of the Quran talk about Musa alayhi salam and Bani Israel, and 50 surahs out of the 114. It talks about Ibrahim alayhi salam all over the place, Shu'aib and some other prophets. But subhanAllah, although the Quran was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam over 23 years, there's not a single contradiction, although the stories were repeated all over the place. And the point of the repetition was, the focus is always different in the Quran. It doesn't give the exact same story, it gives some details in one surah that are not mentioned in another surah. For example, if you look at Surah Kahf, yes, the story of Musa alayhi salam is mentioned, but the highlight of the story is Musa wal-Khidr. If you read Surah A'raf, the highlight is the suffering of Bani Israel. If you read Surah Qasas, the highlight is the childhood of Musa alayhi salam, how he killed an Egyptian by mistake, and his marriage in Midian. The focus is always different. There is no contradiction. But some details are shared, and still there is no contradiction in the story. And there are some ayat that are repeated in the Quran, like فَبِأَيَّ أَلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانَ, and so on and so forth. And this style is beautiful, even in English. Those who were listening to Martin Luther King back in 1964, they were touched every time he repeated, I have a dream, I have a dream, I have a dream, let freedom ring, let freedom ring. So there was no repetition here. He was emphasizing the points he was making. So there is no repetition in the Quran. It is used for emphasis. So this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Quran. And every time when people attack the Quran and they say it has contradictions, the grammar is wrong, it is not fasih, so on and so forth, some say, Robert Spencer and some others, I always tell the brothers and sisters when they respond to the attacks, is this something new that, you know, was leveled against the Quran in the last 10, 15 years? Or is this something that existed from the beginning of the revelation? Did the people of Mecca say, these are the masters of Arabic, the Arabic language? Did they say at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this Quran is not perfect, this Quran is not fasih, it is not eloquent, the grammar is wrong? There is not a single report. Although the people of Mecca, they were the masters of Arabic. They loved the beauty and the eloquence of the Quran, but they said, we wish that this Quran was revealed to someone who is from, you know, someone who is rich or a king or someone, so we follow them. That was the only thing that they questioned about the Quran. Now you see someone in the last 10, 15 years who can't even read Fatiha correct. They say, oh, it has wrong grammar, mistakes, this, that. I tell them, if the people of Mecca, If they decided to go to war to stop the spread of Islam, instead of pointing out the grammatical mistakes, this shows you that it has no mistakes. You don't know the grammar, you don't know the style, you don't know Arabic, so this is why to you this is a mistake, but the Quran in Arabic has no mistakes. It is perfect, it is the standard. And all the Arabic grammar and everything else, this came later and it was based on the Quran. So the Quran is the standard, not the Arabic language. The Arabic language was later modeled after the Quran because this is the highest point in Arabic literature. Now, what are the challenges of translating the Quran? And I believe some of the other speakers, inshallah, will highlight this aspect, but I'm going to touch it on this very quickly. We know that before 1905, the Quran was not translated by a Muslim. To the best of my knowledge, Muhammad Abdul Hakim Khan from India, Pakistan, he was the first Muslim to translate, again, to the best of my knowledge. But in the 300 years before that, from the year Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam passed away, the year 632, till 1905, not a Muslim translated the whole Quran in English. Because Muslims always believe the Quran has to be read in the original language of revelation, which is Arabic. And of course, that gave room to a lot of missionaries and Orientalists from Europe to translate or actually mistranslate the Quran. And almost all of them, I was talking to Imam Hassanin, everyone who translated the Quran from the non-Muslim community before 1905, they said in the introduction, like Ross and William and many others, they said in the introduction, we didn't translate the Quran because we love the Quran or we love Islam. We translated the Quran to show you the mistakes and to show you the falsehood of Islam and the Quran. That was the intention. And you see, subhanAllah, you look at Surah Al-Kawthar, for example. إِنَّ أَعْطَيْنَاكَ الْكَوْثَرَ فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ إِنَّ شَانِئَكَ هُوَ الْأَبْتَرُ. So when they translated فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ, everyone knows in the Muslim community, regardless of your madhab or your belief, فَصَلِّ لِرَبِّكَ وَانْحَرْ صَلِّ صَلَاةَ الْعِيدِ عِيدُ الْأَضْحَى, and go and offer your qurbani. This is the most common understanding of the ayah. But if you see someone like Ross and William and some others, they say, pray to your Lord and go and sacrifice your enemies. Kill non-Muslims. So this is how they translated. So they made the Quran look like a terrible thing. So when someone translates the Quran, they have to have some qualifications to translate. Like when you, if someone needs to go to a doctor for a surgery, they need to find a qualified doctor. They don't pick a guy off the street to go to for a surgery. I don't know how many of you speak Urdu. I'm from Egypt, but I love biryani, so miachi Urdu boltahun. How many of you speak Urdu? MashaAllah. Acha. That's beautiful, man. You have a saying, we have a saying in Urdu, because I consider myself Urdu speaking. Neem Hakim Khatra Jaan, Neem Mulla Khatra Iman. Half a doctor is dangerous to your life, your health, and half a scholar is dangerous to your iman, right? Same thing for translation. So when someone translates the Quran, people think the translation is actually the Quran, this is what Allah is saying, and if there is a mistake, they accept it as is. They don't challenge the translation. So the person has to be qualified to translate the Quran. I've seen, alhamdulillah, many translations of the Quran. Some of them were done by qualified scholars, but some of them are not. I'm not going to mention names, but one of the translators, and this is the only thing that he has in his CV, that he is an electronic engineer, right? Electronics engineer. What are the qualifications? Electronic engineer. Or I'm a plumber. Or maybe I'm a teacher of math and science. What do you have to do with the translation of the Quran? So this is the problem. We believe in specialization in everything except when it comes to the imam job or the translation job. Everyone is a mufti, everyone is a scholar. Alhamdulillah, so we made it to the Guinness World of Records. We have 1.6 billion muftis in the Muslim world. Alhamdulillah. So for someone to translate the Quran, it's just like for someone to do tafsir of the Quran, like the big scholars of Islam who translated the Quran, you have to understand the Arabic language, and you study Quran and different tafsir, you know nahwan, sarfan, balagha, And in translation, of course, you study the translations of the Quran and how words are used and the culture and everything. And I also believe if someone translates the Quran in a perfect way, they have to be a Muslim. With all due respect to all the non-Muslims who translated the Quran with a good intention, they always made mistakes. They always made mistakes. So no matter how good intentions you have, you will always make mistakes in the translation because you are an outsider. We need someone from within the faith who is a scholar to translate the Quran. You see translations like N.J. Dawood, for example. Iraqi Jew, his translation is featured upstairs. And he made a lot of accusations against Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he said Islam hates us and that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was against us. And in the translation, he made so many mistakes. A good translation of the Quran has to be done directly from the Arabic language. And if you are translating from Arabic into English, you have to be a native speaker of at least, of course, one of them. You're either a native speaker of Arabic who translated, or you have a mastery of the English language, or you're an Arab who has mastery of English, right? So you are a native speaker of one language and you have a good mastery over the other one. But if you don't speak Arabic, it's not your native tongue, and you don't speak English, it's not your native tongue, you will always be making mistakes. Why? Because you will be doing two things, and this is what I have noticed. You either use a dictionary to translate. You can use a dictionary to translate an article from a newspaper, but not the Quran. Or in some cases, when they got so frustrated, they were pulling their hair off, and steam was coming out of their head because they couldn't translate something, then they just copy previous translations. I'm going to copy Yusuf Ali and other translations. But this did not guarantee accuracy in translation. So you have to translate directly from Arabic. I've seen some translations that are translated into English, not from Arabic, but from Urdu, from Turkish, from French. There's always a missing link in between. You lose the touch of the Arabic. I don't usually trust sectarian translations, like for example, a translation by Rashad Khalifa. He was from Egypt. Alhamdulillah, a lot of good people come from Egypt, but also a lot of bad people come from there. You are either too good or too bad. So Rashad Khalifa, back in the late 1980s, he claimed to be a prophet of God, you know, and so on and so forth. So that was rejected by the Muslim community. But the point was, he used the translation as a platform to support his prophethood. For example, and this is very common in people who claim to be prophets after Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They say, he used, of course, if you want to claim something and to prove that you are a prophet or anything, you can always find proof in the Quran. He says, In Surah Baqarah, ayah number 30 to 33, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. This is the proof of his prophethood. He says, Allah says right there, I'm putting a khalifa on earth to get direct communication with Allah. And my last name is Khalifa, it's talking about me. إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. His name is Rashad Khalifa. Also, there are some translations that do plastic surgery on the Quran, like feministic translations. Layla Bakhtiar, for example, her translation is feministic, right? And there are some ayat that are very clear, very straightforward in fiqh, and she twisted the translation to fit her own understanding of the text. It's a feministic translation, and so on and so forth. So if you want someone to understand the Quran, the person has to have the qualifications. She herself, in the introduction to her work, she said, I'm not qualified to translate. Why did you translate it in the first place if you think you're not qualified? But anyway, the other translations, many of them are old, archaic. They use a very old style. So for example, they still use the word retribution instead of punishment. They use the word corn to refer, for example, in the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, when the king saw the dream, وَسَبْعَ سُنْبُلَاتٍ. So Yusuf alayhi, for example, used the word corn. Corn is a North American thing. It is not an African or an Asian thing. It didn't exist at the time of Yusuf alayhi salam in Egypt. But the thing is, in the 19th century, in the early 20th century, they used corn to refer to any grain. But not anymore. Back then, they used the word ass to refer to a donkey. Now the word has a different connotation, so we shouldn't use it. The mistakes in the translation, there are, I would say, about four different types of mistakes in translation. The first one is misunderstanding the style of the Quran. And I'm going to give examples of each. So misunderstanding the style of the Quran. Number two, misunderstanding the grammar of the Quran, the context of the Quran. And when people do literal translations of the Quran, they see the word, they open the dictionary, this is what it says in translation, the literal word, and we put it in there. And this leads to two things. Inaccuracies. So when people read the Quran in translation, they see the mistakes. They say, oh, Allah made mistakes in the Quran. And number two, they see a lot of contradictions in the Quran. And I'll give you some examples of the contradictions based on translation, not the Arabic. So number one, not understanding the context and the style of the Quran. So this is what you get when you use the dictionary to translate the Quran. This is one of my favorite mistranslations of the Quran. In Surah Anbiya 21, Ayah 87. وَذَنُّونِ إِذْ ذَهَبَ مُغَاضِبًا فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ So they saw this word, نَقْدِر. And of course, in the Arabic language, when you say, قَدَرْتُ عَلَى إِمَامِ حَسَنَيْن, for example, I overpowered him, I had power over him. But they didn't realize that the word is used in the Quran to mean other things. So the word قَدَرَ عَلَى, so basically Yunus alayhi salam, when he left his town in a rage, his people did not believe. He knew that the punishment was set to come, so he left without permission. فَظَنَّ أَلَّا نَقْدِرَ عَلَيْهِ Thinking that Allah has no power over him. This is what almost everyone said in translation. So when you go home, inshallah, make sure you compare and see. And I believe in that booklet, I think we have some copies outside, we made comparisons between these different translations, including the Click Quran, to see how we did on some of these mistakes. So Yunus alayhi salam thought that Allah has no power over him. If you ask any like grade 2 student, do you think Allah has no power over you? And of course they say Allah is the most powerful. He has power over everyone. Now the meaning is not related to physical power. It is talking about what Allah mentions in other ayat in the Quran. Allahu yabsutu rizqa liman yasha'u wa yaqdir. Allah gives abundant or unlimited rizq to whoever He wants, and He gives limited rizq. So qadr here means limited. He thought that Allah would not restrain him, put him in a tight place in the belly of the whale. It doesn't say he has no power over him. It says Allah will restrain him, right? He thought Allah would not restrain him. So this is the correct meaning. The other ones are not acceptable. The other one, in Surah Najm, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ لَا يُسَمُّونَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَسْمِيَةَ الْأُنْثَى Almost everyone says that the people of Mecca who don't believe in Akhirah, they give the Malaika female names. What are the female names? Well, in the Quran, there are three that are mentioned by name in the Quran. We have Jibreel, we have Mikael, and we have Malik, the guard of Jahannam. So none of them is a female in the hadith. None of them is a female. What are they talking about? They say those who don't believe in Akhirah, they give the Malaika female names. Allata wal Uzza, this is a totally different thing. They were not modeled after angels. They were modeled after, one of them was a statue of a human being. Another one was a statue of a tree. The other one was just a solid rock. It has nothing to do with the Malaika. So there is also this misconception that Allata wal Uzza wa Manat al-Salith al-Ukhra, they were Malaika, they were not. So what is the proper understanding? In many other ayat in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala criticizes the people of Mecca for calling the Malaika, the angels, the daughters of Allah. وَجَعَلُوا الْمَلَائِكَةَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَانِ إِنَاثًا So they claim that the Malaika were the daughters of Allah. So we shouldn't say they gave the Malaika female names. The correct answer, understanding is they labeled them as female. They categorized them as female. Right? So this is the proper understanding of the ayah. Now, when you don't translate the ayah because you misunderstood the grammar of the Arabic or the balagha, you'll always make mistakes in the translation. And they say, well, there's a contradiction right there. And every time I check a translation, I've checked like over 100 of them, I have never seen any translation translated this one correctly. None. The first one is the Clear Quran. Now I'm going to give a little bit of background to understand the correct translation of this ayah. So ayah 111 and ayah 113 of Surah Baqarah. It's talking about the Jews and Christians. So everyone says in translation of the first one, because they misunderstood this word. This is the key word for the misunderstanding. In the Arabic language, the word or has two meanings. Either للتخيير or للتنويع. Two different things. So I'm going to give you both to see how they got, you know, they got it wrong. So when everyone says, the Jews and Christians say that no one will go to Jannah except Jews and Christians. Jews or Christians. So this means that the Jews say both Jews and Christians are going to Jannah, and the Christians say both Jews and Christians are going to Jannah. This is what everyone has in their own translation. Now when you read Ayah 113, there is a big contradiction there. They say the Christians have nothing to stand on. They have the wrong aqidah, they are going to Jahannam. And the Christians say the Jews have the wrong aqidah, they are going to Jahannam. So they say about each other that this group is going to Jahannam or going to Jannah. So how do you reconcile both ayat? Because there is a contradiction here. So the word or is the key. So everyone translated the ayah to mean takhir, but it means tanwir here. The correct translation of the ayah, the Jews and the Christians each, and this is the word or, each say that no one is going to Jannah except those of our own faith. This is the proper understanding. There's no contradiction now. You translate the word aw to each, no problem. But if you say and, then it means another thing, and there is a big contradiction here. Also, at the beginning of Surah Ma'arij, this is a very common one. سَأَلَ سَائِلٌ بِعَذَابٍ وَاقِعٍ إِلَى آخِ الْآيَةِ. So someone came to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to challenge him and say, well, this is not possible. Resurrection, being raised from the dead, is impossible. It will never happen. And at the end of the section, it says, the people of Mecca, إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا. They think it's far off. This is what everyone said. But we see it as close by. So this means, at the beginning of the passage, the people of Mecca, the people of Arabia, the pagans, they say that resurrection is impossible, it is not happening, they are making fun of it. At the end of the ayah, إِنَّهُمْ يَرَوْنَهُ بَعِيدًا وَنَرَاهُ قَرِيبًا, it means they see it as far off. It's coming, but it is very slow. It's going to take maybe thousands of years, and we see it as close by. This is not the correct translation. I have not seen anyone who translated it correctly. The translation should be, they see it as impossible, and we see it as inevitable. If it says ba'idan in the Arabic language, it means ba'idan an al-uqul. It is impossible, it is beyond comprehension, it will never happen. But you say ba'idan means far off, it's coming, but slow, it's taking a long time, or it is distant in place, this is a different thing. And there is a contradiction right there. Now when you translate the Quran literally, the translation becomes silly actually, and it doesn't convey the meaning. And again, these examples I'm giving you here, these are very popular translations, especially like the ones from Saudi Arabia. Because sometimes when we give someone the Clear Quran, they say, no, we have the translation here, the Noble Quran, Sahih International from Saudi Arabia. It is sacred, it's holy, we're not reading your translation. But Ya Ammu, it has mistakes in it. You know, no. From Saudi, correct, perfect, Muqaddas, we can't say anything. No. So I give them some of the examples, and these are popular translations. The most popular translations in the world. Yusuf Ali, Noble Quran, Pikthol, Sahih International, and many others. For example, Sahih International, the ayat in Surah Kahf are talking about the Day of Judgment and how the world will be destroyed and the earth will be flat, there is nothing there. And she said, وَتَرَى الْأَرْضَ بَارِزَةً. We blow the mountains away, وَتَرَى الْأَرْضَ بَارِزَةً. In the Arabic language, when she used the dictionary, the word bariz, if I say Imam Hassanin, Rajulun bariz, he's a prominent man. This is what you get from the dictionary. But the meaning here, وَتَرَى الْأَرْضَ بَارِزَةً, it means exposed, laid bare. There is nothing on top, empty. This is the meaning. Bariz, it means there is nothing on to cover it, right? So she used the word prominent, which is, I believe, is the opposite of the meaning. But this is what you get when you translate using the dictionary. Another translation by Sahih International, يوم يدعو الداعي إلى شيء نكر in Surah Qamar. The day the caller will summon to شيء نكر. So she used the dictionary. Nukur means forbidding. So Israfil, when he will blow the trumpet, he will call to something forbidding. What in the world does that mean? Something forbidding? It doesn't make any sense. Another meaning of the word nukur, which is correct here, the caller will summon people to something terrifying, something horrifying, which is the judgment, standing before Allah for judgment. And this is the correct meaning. Now another mistake, I call it the literal translation of the Quran. Some translators, I know three of them personally. One of them was my professor at Al-Azhar. What he did basically, he did something good, but it is not perfect. When you fix a word in English for a word in Arabic. So for example, every time you see the word sirata, you translate it as path. When you see the word sabil, you translate it as way. It's good, it works most of the time, but sometimes you make terrible mistakes when you fix a word for every word in the Quran. For example, the word khayr. In Surah Baqarah, وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ يُوَفَّ إِلَيْكُمْ أَوْ يَعْلَمْهُ اللَّهِ in the other ayah. Whatever charity you give, Allah will give you the reward and Allah knows it. So the word khayr here means charity. But most of the time, the word khayr in the Quran does not mean charity. So when this translator fixed the word charity throughout the Quran, terrible mistakes. And it gives actually the opposite meaning in many ayat in the Quran. In Surah, وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٍ It's talking about the kuffar who are greedy. They love this world. They love to take over. They are very greedy. And he said in translation, and this person that Allah is criticizing for his greed, he is in extreme love for charity. Because he fixed the word khayr for charity. It is the opposite. It is talking about this person's greed, not his love for charity. Because greed is to take to yourself, charity is to give other people. So he said he loves charity. Although it is talking about love for greed. This person is greedy. Another example, when the people of Mecca and the Ahzab in Surah Ahzab, وَرَدَّ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِغَيْظِهِمْ لَمْ يَنَالُوا خَيْرًا They left empty-handed. They didn't take anything. No ghanima, nothing. And he said, the people of Mecca, they left without a charity. What are you talking about? It is not talking about charity, right? If it compares to the people of Mecca and the people of Ad, or the people of Tubba, he said in the ayah, أَهُمْ خَيْرٌ أَمْ قَوْمُ Tubba? Are they superior in might or the people of Tubba? He said, are they more charitable or the people of Tubba? Ya Ammu, it has nothing to do with charity. Totally different. Another example, and this is very common in translation, is when they say, for example, نَسُوا اللَّهَ فَنَسِيَهُمْ Like in Surah Tawbah, ayah 67, they forgot Allah, so Allah forgot them. And you ask him, does Allah forget? Because in the Quran, in many places, فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ يَضِلُّ رَبِّي وَلَا يَنْسَى وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَ Allah does not forget anyone, He does not forget anything. Why do you translate, they forgot Allah and Allah forgot them? They say, it says forgotten in Arabic, so this style in Balagha is called Mushakala. It is only similar in the word, but the meaning is different. So the meaning is they neglected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will neglect them in Jahannam, or out of His rahmah. But He didn't forget them, He knows that they existed. Also, يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَهُوَ خَادِعُونَ Deception is not acceptable for Allah. Allah does not deceive anyone. Allah is not deceptive. So they say they deceived Allah and Allah deceived them. But the best translation, they try to deceive Allah and Allah outwits them. So Allah is turning their deception on them, but He does not go out of His way and deceive. So we should use a word that is suitable for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also another translation in the Quran, I met some African-American brothers and sisters, and they are offended when they read most of the translations of the Quran because they say, like this one here, Surah Al-Imran 106. يَوْمَ تَبْيَضُّ وُجُوهٌ وَتَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهٌ So it's talking about the Day of Judgment, and how the believers, how their faces will look like, and how the kuffar, their faces will look like. So most of the translations say some faces will be white and some faces will be black. The white people will go to Jannah, the black people go to Jahannam for barbecue. You know, a barbecue, this is my artistic license. It is not talking about white or black, because Allah is explaining this in other ayat in the Quran. وَجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ مُسْفِرَةٌ ضَاحَكَةٌ مُسْفِرَةٌ وَوَجُوهٌ عَلَيْهَا غَبَرَةٌ. So the actual meaning is some faces will be bright and some faces will be gloomy. Because Bilal radiallahu anhu, a black man, his face will be bright. But some white people, even in Arabia at the time, they had some white people like Abu Lahab or Abu Jahl, you know. They were white people. Based on the description, they were white. But their faces will be gloomy, because they rejected Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So it doesn't mean black or white, it means gloomy and bright, because this is also explained in the in other ayat, and even till this day in the Arabic language. If I have two children, one of them passes the exam and they're at the top of their class, I say bayyattu wajhi, and the other one sawwattu wajhi, because they failed. So I say bayyattu wajhi, you made me proud, and the other one, you put me to shame. It doesn't mean black and white here. It's a metaphorical thing. Also, it's very funny. Some of the translations are funny. Some of them don't make sense if they use the dictionary to translate. But some are funny. Like in Surah Ahqaf, when the jinn listen to the وَصَرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفَرًا مِنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ, they listen to the recitation of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He had a beautiful voice. They accepted Islam on the spot, and they went to make da'wah to their fellow jinn. When they said, Ya qawmana, ya qawmana, everyone in translation said, Oh, our people, hey, our people. They are not people, they are jinn. They shouldn't say, Oh, our people, they should say, our fellow jinn. Because they are jinn, they are not human beings. But because when they see qawmana in other places in the Quran, it means people, but here it's totally different. Now, the Arabic style. When you translate from the Arabic, you have to understand the style of the Arabic. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He, in the Quran, He refers to Himself, for example, or He talks about someone in the masculine form. The non-Muslims say, well, how is Allah a male? Why do you say He? We tell them, you don't understand. In the Arabic language, because we don't have the word it in Arabic, so we have she for a female, and we have he for he and it. And in English, we don't want to use the word it to refer to Allah, so we use he, out of respect for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the Arabic language, when a kid is born, and we don't know if it's a boy or a girl, I ask my brother, ماذا سميتمو? What did you call him? And I don't know if it's a boy or a girl. We use he in Arabic to mean it, because I don't know the gender. So we use it in that sense. And this is why, in the clear Quran, this is probably the first one that I have seen. When it says he in the Quran, and it refers to humanity in general, we use they or them. We don't use he anymore. If it is referring to humanity, we use they, or we say someone, or human beings, or we use a general term. So it is not a chauvinistic translation. If the gender is not intended, so we leave it open to include everyone, both brothers and sisters. Now, again, I have not seen this one translated correctly anywhere. For example, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. And subhanAllah, some of the ayat that we read all the time in salah, like اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ, most of them said, guide us to the straight path. It doesn't say to. Because you are already on the Sirat al-Mustaqim. It doesn't say Ihdina ila Sirat al-Mustaqim. It says Ihdina Sirat, because we are already on there, on the Sirat. So it should be guide us along, because we are already there. You shouldn't say guide us to, and so on and so forth. The other one is Qul huwa Allahu Ahad. Ahad is different from Wahid. They are two different words. The word Wahid in the Arabic language, it means one. But Ahad, it means one that is not made of parts or elements. For example, in Christianity, they say Allah is one, but He is made of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. So Allah says, no, He is one, and He is Ahad. Ahad means He's not made up of three. There is no Trinity. It's one, Ahad. So it should be translated as Allah is one and indivisible. You cannot divide into parts. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. For example. فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرًا. Everyone says in translation, indeed with difficulty comes ease, indeed with difficulty comes ease. This is what everyone does. Now, Alhamdulillah, at Al-Azhar we studied Arabi Nahw Sarf Balagha for 30 years, so we know these structures in the Arabic language. When a word is repeated in the Arabic language twice, and if it has al in it, it means it's the same word. And if a word is repeated without the al at the beginning, the definite article, it means two different things. To explain, if I say, I met the imam, and I gave the imam food, biryani. Am I talking about the same imam or different imams? I met the guy, I gave the guy money. It's the same guy. But if I say without the definitive article, al, the, I met a guy, and I gave a guy some money. Two different people. So these two words are the same, but these two words are different. So the meaning will be, indeed with every difficulty comes ease, surely with that same difficulty comes more ease, because there are two. One difficulty, because it is the same, and two different eases. So when Allah will test you with a difficulty, He will send you ease after ease. We understand this from Arabic, and there is a saying attributed to the Prophet ﷺ, and some say some of the Sahaba, لَنْ يَغْلِبَ عُسْرٌ يُسْرَيْنِ. One hardship will not beat two eases, based on this, the understanding of the ayah. Another common mistake in the translation, when they see the word repeated in the Arabic language, one in the verb form and one in the noun form, they repeat the word in translation. Like say for example in Surah Waqi'ah, إِذَا رُجَّتِ الْأَرْضُ رَجَّةً. In the Arabic language, if the word is repeated in the noun form, this is used for emphasis. So they say, when the earth is shaken with a shaking, what is that supposed to mean? It should be when the earth is shaken violently. Because when the word is repeated in the noun form, it is used for emphasis, to show you the power and the magnitude. Another common mistake in the translation, I know this is a little bit complicated, I'm going deep here, but I'm almost done, inshallah. Khalas, two more slides and I'll be done. You're not hearing me anymore. Tafdil style. Tafdil means when you have two things or two people, they share a quality, but one of them is bigger than the other. Yani if I say Imam Mustafa is handsome, Imam Hassanain is more handsome, or he is the most handsome person in the room. Right? Takbir. So this is what we call tafdil. Two people, they share a quality, but one of them supersedes the other. Like when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the people of Pharaoh, they were more powerful than the people of Mecca. And so on and so forth. Or in Surah Kahf, أَنَا أَكْثَرُ مِنْكَ مَالًا وَأَعَزُّ نَفْرًا. In the man who has two gardens, he says, I have more money than you and I have more manpower than you. We share some quality, but I have more. This style is common in the Quran, but there is also another confusing style. بيقولوا التفضيل على غير بابه. It looks like تفضيل. It seems they share the same quality, but they actually don't. For example, when Yusuf alayhi salam in Surah 12, Surah Yusuf, Ayah 33, قَالَ رَبِّ السِّجْنُ أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ مِمَّا يَدْعُونَنِي إِلَيْهِ. Everyone says in translation, Ya Allah, I love going to jail more than my love to zina. Or committing or going to jail is dearer to my heart than committing zina, adultery. Did he love committing zina in the first place? Of course not. So there is no sharing in the quality here. And one of them supersedes the other. It looks like tafdil, but ala ghayri babi, it is not tafdil. So the correct translation, he said, Ya Allah, I would rather go to jail than to do what they are asking me to. There is no dearer to him or more beloved to my heart. And so, no, I would do this. I will never do this. The other example in Surah Hijr, for example. When Lut, alayhi salam, when the angels came in a human form, and you know the people of Lut, they were after the men, they were after other men. So when they saw the angels coming in this handsome male form, they came after them. فلوط عليه السلام said, قال يا قومي هؤلاء بناتي هن أطهر لكم. My daughters, the singles of my ummah, because he had only two girls, two daughters, but he's talking about the females of his ummah, the singles, they are purer for you in marriage than these men. There is no sharing in the quality here. He's not saying that the single females of his ummah are purer for you in relationship than these men. There's no sharing in the quality. So the women are pure, the men, the other men, they're not pure in the first place to start with, right? So the translation would be, oh people, these daughters of my ummah, they are pure for you in marriage. He's not making a comparison here. There's also another style that is always misunderstood in the translation. And I'll give one example and khalas. Say for example, two people are mentioned in a sentence and the sentence ends with two objectives or descriptions of these two people. So what they do in the translation, yani say for example, Imam Mustafa met Imam Hassanain crying and laughing. Everyone in translation says that Imam Mustafa met Imam Hassanain and Imam Hassanain was crying and laughing at the same time. Doesn't make any sense. This style is called laf or nashr watay in the Arabic language. The first quality goes to the first person and the second one goes to the second one. They're not both for the second one. It's called laf wa nashr in the Arabic language. We send every quality to every person. So the first one goes to the first and the second goes to the second. For example, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَى عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبِسُطْهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطِ فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْصُورًا. Do not waste your money and do not withhold. You don't become cheap and stingy. So there are two qualities. فَتَقْعُدَ مَلُومًا مَحْصُورًا. So they use مَلُومًا مَحْصُورًا for the second action, which is withholding your hand. But actually, the first one goes to the first and the second goes to the second. I've never seen anyone translated this correctly based on the understanding of this qa'idah in the Arabic grammar and nahw. So the perfect translation would be, do not be tight-fisted, for you will be blameworthy, nor so open-handed, for you will end up in poverty. So you give every quality to every person. Now you give the adjective to every action. So first to the first and second to the second. This is the proper understanding. But if you give both adjectives or descriptions to the second one and you leave the first one with no description, then there is a mistake in the translation. So now what makes the Clear Quran stand out as a good translation? Number one, it was a teamwork. More than 75 people were involved. Scholars and imams and editors, even high school kids were involved, little kids were involved, brothers and sisters, Muslims and non-Muslims. Actually, three non-Muslims were involved in the making of the translation. Two of them took shahada the same day when we were about to finish the translation. Alhamdulillah. So this translation stands out because of four things actually. And if you want to evaluate a translation, any translation of the 50 here or the 112 that have been made in English, you have to look at four things. Clarity. How clear is the translation? If you give the translation to a grade 4 or a grade 5, are they able to understand it or not? A non-Muslim, are they able to understand it or not? And this is why this old style maketh thou, thine, all the big words imitating the King James style doesn't fly anymore. Because people, because of the, you know, time is very limited and people have so many things to do, they don't have time to open up the dictionary and look for the meaning. Clarity has to be clear. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the Qur'an, Qur'an mubeen, at least twice in the Qur'an. One in Surah Hijr at the beginning, one at the end of Surah Yasin. Qur'an mubeen, it's clear. Mubeen in the Arabic language means bayin, wadah. The clear Qur'an, and this is where we got the title from. Number two, accuracy. Do you really understand the Arabic text and the tafsir of it to be able to translate into English? If the understanding is not correct, then the translation would be incorrect. Eloquence. We know the Arabic is so powerful. The text of the Quran is so beautiful. And subhanAllah, when I was translating the Quran, I used to stay up all night. 2-3 years I was working on the translation. I must have consumed like 5 tons of dates and Earl Grey tea. Like I was Tim Horton's biggest customer during this time. I used to break my head over some ayat in the Quran. SubhanAllah, the Arabic is so powerful, the English is so dumb. It's like when you have a bucket full of water and you try to pour it in a small cup. It doesn't fit, man. The Arabic has meanings and shades of meanings and metaphors and beautiful, man. And the English is like, oh, whatever. So the eloquence, and we try to reflect some of this in the English language. We try to reflect the rhymes and sometimes the rhythms of the Arabic. We use good words, but understandable. So we use words like overwhelming. We use words like tremendous. There are big words, but everyone knows the words. And the flow, as I said, we used to have public readings. We have a room full of people, 15, 20 people. We read out the translation at least twice. And people would listen and say, this flows very good. This doesn't flow. We tried to fix it and so on and so forth. And alhamdulillah, we put surah introductions. And what is new about this translation, actually, it's a thematic translation. I have broken down the translation based on their themes. Yes, the same order. But I put titles. Yani the first five ayat of Surah Baqarah, the qualities of the muttaqin, the righteous. Then the next two ayat, they talk about the kuffar, qualities of the kafirun. Then the next 17 ayat, they talk about the munafiqun, the qualities of the hypocrites. And so on and so forth. And in Surah Kahf, it has four stories. People of the cave, number one. Number two, the man with the two gardens. Number three, Musa wal-Khidr. Number four, Dhul Qarnayn. I put titles. And within the story, I divide and I put titles. Like Musa, when he met Al-Khidr, the boy incident, the ship incident, the wall incident. And so I put small titles. It becomes very easy for people to know. It's like, it becomes like a story. And it makes it easier for people when they make hifz, they know where to begin and where to end. When the theme or the story is over and a new story begins. This will help them know where to begin and where to end. Also, this is something that has not been done before. I divided the surah. They are the same order. But before you read the surah, you know what it talks about based on the theme. So the Quran, generally, any ayah in the Quran can be placed under one of three themes. Either doctrine, your relationship with Allah, the relationship with the people, or stories, or al-ghayb, the unseen. So I used these three symbols in the index at the beginning. So before you read any surah, you know which of the three themes this surah is talking about. So surah, for example, Surah Baqarah, it talks about the three, because it talks about Allah, your relationship with Him, it talks about riba, marriage, salah, and it talks about stories like the story of the cow, and so on and so forth. And it talks about al-ghayb, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His description, His qualities. But Surah Yusuf has one symbol, which is the story. It's only a story. It doesn't have the two other themes. And at the end of the Quran, we have the thematic index. I divided the themes, the topics of the Quran, based on these three. So doctrine, I listed all the subjects. Stories, I listed all the stories. The 25 prophets are mentioned in the Quran. Where can you find their stories? And the other stories, and also the ghaib. If you want to read about Jannah, Jahannam, judgment, I put a third section in there. It makes it super easy, inshallah, for people to understand. Now I'm going to do a quiz. I have three of them. If you know which one of them is the clear Quran, based on everything that I have said, if you are not asleep, and if you are paying attention, and you're not playing with your cell phone, you will be able to figure out which one of them is the clear Quran. And I'm going to give you a free copy of the Quran, the black one, not the other one, because, yeah, I'll give you that. So we have some copies here for sale, inshallah. You can check out the translation, and this will help us print some more, inshallah. I'm going to pick three volunteers. And we need, because the brothers are double the number of the sisters, we'll get two brothers and one sister. لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ. Can we get two brothers to volunteer? You're getting a free copy of the Quran. Signed, so you can sell it on Kijiji for $70. Two brothers and one sister. Okay, we are getting this brother, inshallah. Yes, yes, come here. And one sister, stand here, please. We're not going to embarrass you or anything, inshallah. So you're going to look here. We're going to start with this brother. You read both translations out loud, and you tell me which one you think is the clear Quran based on what I have said. You start with this one.
The sun and the moon run on their fixed courses exactly calculated with measured out stages for each, for reckoning, etc. And the herbs or stars and the trees both prostrate. And the heaven he has raised high, and he has set up the balance. The sun and the moon travel with precision. The stars and the trees bow down in submission. As for the sky, he raised it high and set the balance of justice based on the criteria of the second one. Seems to be
MashaAllah, takbir. Thank you. Take a cup. Take a copy and thank you. Jazakallah. We'll sign it for you later.
Sure, thank you.
The copy is free, but the signature you pay. No, I'm kidding. Jazakallah. The second one, we go with the sister.
Surely the hypocrites seek to deceive Allah, but He outwits them. When they stand up for prayer, they do it half-heartedly, only to be seen by people, hardly remembering Allah at all. Lo, the hypocrites seem to beguile Allah, but it is He who beguileth them. When they stand up to worship, they perform it languidly and to be seen of men, and are mindful of Allah but little.
Okay, Jazakallah, takbir, thank you. Take your copy. Okay, third and last one.
Thus we have granted each messenger and opponent devils from humankind and spirits of sprites, some of whom have inspired others with seductive talk in order to deceive them. If your Lord had so wished, they would not have done so. So leave them alone, as well as anything they may be inventing. And so we have made for every prophet enemies, devilish humans and jinn, whispering to one another with elegant words of deception. Had it been your Lord's will, they would not have done such a thing. So leave them and their deceit. I would say the second one is
more. Ahsant, Jazakallah. Yes, this is the clear Quran. Yeah, you take your copy. Barakallahu fik. Again, these are translations, the Noble Quran, Sahih International, and I believe the third one was Yusuf Ali. So it makes it clear that flow is good and the words are easy to understand, and alhamdulillah, the meaning becomes clear. And as I conclude, inshallah, nothing will replace the Arabic. What we did basically, me and the other translators, we tried to make the Arabic understandable to those who don't understand Arabic. If you know Arabic, don't read my translation. Read the Arabic. Forget about my translation. But if you don't read the Arabic, and now I'm talking about 85% of Muslims, they don't read Arabic. They come from Indonesia, India, Pakistan. Some of them do, but Arabic is not their native tongue. And Europeans and Latinos, they don't know Arabic, so they need translation. And again, it's a human effort. The other translations, they did their best. I did my best. Maybe they made mistakes. I made mistakes too. The reason why the Clear Quran, I think, is a good translation, because we stand on the back of giants. I learned from Yusuf Ali, I learned from Pickthall, I learned from all these other translations, but I started from where they stopped. So I took it to the next level to make it easy, understandable, even for little kids, non-Muslims, to be able to understand the text. Maybe one day someone else will come and do the clearer Quran, or the clearest Quran there is, but at least we did our best and we try to make a difference. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us and forgive our sins. If there is anything good about this translation, it's from Allah. Only the mistakes are mine. Jazakallah khairan. Salaamu alaikum.
Let's call him Brother Shokan to thank our speaker for this very insightful talk today.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much, Dr. Mustafa Fattab. What an enlightening and illuminating discussion, and I thoroughly enjoyed, and I hope you also did. So on behalf of the organizer, I have the pleasure of presenting this to you as a token of our appreciation for tonight's lecture, as well as for all the help you have provided to the organizer. May Allah reward you in this world and the hereafter.
My pleasure. Thanks for the invitation.
And again, we have copies here. I have some copies. The English only is $10. And the Arabic English, the fabulous gold-plated Arabic English is $30, inshallah. Jazakallah. And if you like a signature, I would be happy to provide that. Jazakallah. Any questions before we... yes, brother.
Yeah, can I? The question I had is regarding translation. You clarify some of the translation issues. What about the tafsir issues? I mean, like somebody like Yusuf Ali has a whole tafsir of the Quran, very, very detailed.
Yes.
Do you have comments to share about those?
Yes. I've seen some translations. For example, there's Yusuf Ali, and he did a good job. In the footnotes, he put a lot of information there. To the best of his knowledge. And also, you see, there's the study Quran, Dr. Syed Hussein Nasr from George Washington University. I have some remarks. He did a fantastic job with the footnotes, especially with the linguistic aspects. But my problem is, why do you have to use some aspects of the old style, old English in the translation? You have to make it accessible to young generation as well. Plus, in his case, if the translation is so clear and so easy and very good, you don't need so much information to explain in the footnotes. Like for the Quran, we made the translation itself clear. We didn't have to explain in the footnotes a lot, unless we give Shanu Nuzul, like Asbab al-Nuzul, the historical background so people understand. But if you translate something and you retranslate in the footnote to make it understandable, you could have done the same thing in the translation itself, right? So, explanations are good, unless, for example, they affect the translation. Oh, I'm going to translate anything up there, then I'm going to explain in details down there to make the translation clear. I think they should have done a better job with the translation. So if you see a translation that takes one quarter of the page, and three quarters of the page to explain what they translated, they didn't do a good job, basically. Yes, sir.
Dr. Khattab, thank you very much for the enlightening talk, alhamdulillah. I mean, you are quite right. It's very difficult to translate Arabic into English. Yes. You know, for example, I'm going to buy one copy here. I wanted to know, how would you have translated the words like, for example, Rab? You have translated it Lord. How would you translate the word Tayammu? How would you translate the word Taqwa? How would you translate the word jihad? It would be very interesting, yes, you know, to read. But one thing that I noticed immediately, I'm not criticizing at all, but the word Lord, you know, the Lord seems like, you know, like Jesus,
yeah,
because it comes from the translation of Sel. You know, so your opinion on that?
Of course, one thing we decided to do from the very beginning, we are not going to use Arabic words in the translation. Like say, for example, perform Salah and give Zakah, go for Hajj, people who have taqwa, because when a non-Muslim or someone who doesn't speak Arabic, they come across these words, they always question, okay, what does that mean? And it throws them off, you know, they need to read in English. So what I did with my team, we were sitting there in the room, and some of them are writers and editors, mashallah, here. And I used to explain to them, and we used to come up with 3-4 words to find the closest meaning to the Arabic. We understand that in English, some of the concepts don't exist in English, like dhihar, for example, and tayammum. Even when you use the word prayer for salah, it is not the same. Like for them, the word prayer means dua. But in our case, salah means it's a totally different thing. And this is why we put an introduction to explain these concepts. But we prefer to use English words instead of using Arabic all over the place, because it's going to throw off the non-Arab or non-Muslim readers. So we tried our best. Words like wali, big problem. Rab, big problem. Even the word Allah itself, it's problematic when you translate it to God, right? But what can you do? So I decided for non-Muslims, I'm using the word God in the English only, and for the for Muslims in the Arabic English, I'm using the word Allah, right? Just to satisfy both.
Ladies, let's start wrapping up.
Don't shoot. Yeah, it's very challenging. I'm translating, you're getting a human being, weak, not perfect, translating the perfect word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you expect some defects in there. But I believe this is the best we can do as human beings to bring the divine revelation down to our own understanding. Allah. Yes,
thank you, Dr. Fattab. That was outstanding presentation. Best I've heard of that anywhere, anytime.
I'll send you the check in the mail.
Question I have are two-part.
Yes.
There are certain ayahs of the Quran which are based on the historical context.
Yes.
Which when you interpret or even in Arabic read it without the historical context, they render themselves meaningless.
Yes.
Or confusing at best. So how does your work address that issue? And I'll just ask you the second part of the question as well, so you can answer that as well. In your work in Quran, you are obviously from the great scholars of Al-Azhar. But as you know, there are great scholars in Qum. That in your research, did you come across their works as well? Did you incorporate that as well as Adha? Or
well,
is it just based on Al-Adha?
I relied mostly on the tafasir that are popular in Egypt at Al-Azhar and other old tafasir like Ibn Kathir, Qurtubi, Tabari, so on and so forth, Al-Kashaf, Zamakhshari. And I relied on some modern tafasir like Wizarat al-Awqaf in Egypt and Saudi and some other places. But I wouldn't say I relied per se on the other tafasir. Yes, I read the translations of the Quran by others, Mawlana Muhammad Ali, Sher Ali, and some other translations. And as I said, I learned from everyone. But when it comes to tafasir, I relied heavily on the old and some of the new tafasir within that line of thinking. Allahu
A'lam. And your answer about the historical context.
Historical context, we have books on Shanu Nuzul, like Sayuti, and some other tafsir, like Ibn Kathir, for example, they would put as Bab al-Nuzul. So I also relied on these books for the explanation of the background.
So did you make any references in your translation to those historical events and the sources?
Yes, I
okay, see. Ladies, let's welcome Sister Shanaz Ridina with the Lal Salawat.
Okay. I listed all my references, and I said that Shan al-Nuzul basically I got from Tafsir from Jalaluddin al-Sayuti, and there is also another book. So I relied heavily on these two books for Shan al-Nuzul. Yes,
if I may make a theoretical point after thanking you a lot for this very insightful presentation, at least two of the explanations that you gave for why you chose to translate the way you did have some other theoretical explanations in my view. For instance, when you were talking about the Jews and Christians being the only groups going to heaven, there's a concept of disjunction and the two types of disjunction, inclusive and exclusive, and that basically boils down to human cognition and logic, which is universal. So if you translate that as they believe that Jews and or Christians will go to heaven, with a little bit of reflection, this possibility is even
give him
there,
a solution
even
that people
going to the depth of
stick to the
Hidayah
with a lot of
send
with messengers that
so,
they will be able to trace
and
their
the other
way
one
back.
Is the idea of polysemy when you were talking
we
about
did,
they
a little
achieve,
story
there,
on
Hidayah. So the shape
of
meaning that the second deceit
Hannah,
covers
and how
can be argued to be different
had,
from the shape of meaning that the first deceit covers. So
she had
again, with a little bit of reflection, I think people can see it even without the good
and how
that
she
that
was expecting it to be a boy, and then he started
to
get she was surprised,
the
but
to
she didn't go back on
and
her
of course,
intent.
In debatable
and because of her perseverance and her
you have
intent,
to explain the footnotes.
Allah raised
because
all the
if you just leave the
ayat, and,
I'm not saying all the Qur'an is like this, but there are some ayat you need
Quran,
to give a little bit of background
sort of
and explain to people. And one thing I actually did in the translation, I relied on my understanding as someone who studied the Arabic of the Quran extensively. So I didn't align myself, for example, with the Sunni understanding or the Shia understanding or the Qadiani or Ahmadi. I relied heavily on the Arabic itself. I tried to stay under the influence of the Hebrew writers. I tried to remain true to the original itself.
Why did Allah
based on my understanding
of
the Arabic language for so many years. Again, nothing will replace the Arabic.
Can you see any similarities between Musa and our Prophet or our Ummah?
Barakallahu fiq. More questions?
Yes, okay. Prophet is known to say that you are
your
telling Imam Ali that you are to me like Harun was
any,
to Musa. Right? But the difference is that there will be no prophet after Harun became the prophet.
From Allah, how that have they read this translation and they are the agreement with what you translation?
Yes, Al-Azhar, I sent them copies of the translation and they formed a committee from the Islamic Studies in English department, and they reviewed the translation over a year and they gave us an approval. And if you look at the Arabic-English translation on the back cover, we put the letter of approval from Al-Azhar.
Right.
It has
we
been officially approved by the Canadian Council of Imams, by ISNA and some
and
other organizations.
And if you look at the two Ummahs which Musa faced, if you look at
and the good thing, alhamdulillah, we're
Musa
always open for feedback. I receive feedback from people and I study it with the editing team and we make changes as we go. Alhamdulillah. Yes, bro.
There are many youths like myself who lack interest fundamentally in studying about Quran and you know, getting to know more, but maybe at a shallow level we know a lot, we know enough, but you know, to get a more deep understanding. So what would you advise me to a youth to actually gain maximum benefit from the Quran and get inspired by the Quran?
Alhamdulillah, barakallahu, good question. I mentioned at the beginning that I got so many people involved in the making of the translation, 75. I was the oldest one in the team. I was 37 at the time. Now I'm 40, right? So this gives you an idea of who was involved in the making. Young imams and scholars and people my age. So when you have people our age, so this means one thing to me. The people your age were the main focus of this work. To bring the to make the translation accessible to you. We put the titles, we broke down the titles, we didn't put a lot of information in the footnotes, just a little bit to understand the background and the idea about the themes and the thematic thing. So it becomes like a story and it becomes enjoyable to people your age when they read the translation. And I think the best thing to do is when you read the Quran and you are able to understand it, and we made it clear that the best thing about the Quran is if you understand it correctly and you try to apply it to your life and you can relate to the translation if you understand it. If you think this work is not accessible or difficult or it is not meant for you, you cannot relate to it, then it would be very difficult for me to convince you to read it. But when you read the translation, you feel like it is relevant to your life, it is accessible and it is easy. Like at the beginning of Surah Kahf, for example, sometimes I put stories and I tried, because the Quran is not arranged in the Mus'haf in a chronological order. It is based on the final revelations. And I put an introduction to explain the main themes and to connect this surah with the one before and the one after, and if there's something nice to highlight. So for example, at the beginning of Surah Kahf, I said, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is a hadith, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said there is a hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, on the day of Yawm al-Qiyamah, your feet will not be moved until you are questioned about four things. The youth, years of your life, what did you do in those years? Your money, what did you do with your money? Your knowledge and your life, how you spent your life. And I said, subhanAllah, this beautiful hadith, authentic hadith, relates to the four stories in the surah. The first one about the youth in the cave, the man with the two gardens and the money, and the man of knowledge with Musa alayhi salam and Dhul Qarnayn, who spent his life in the service of Allah. So this is why people read Surah Kahf, for example, on the day of Jummah, to remember these four questions you will get on Akhirah. So I highlighted something like this, and a lot of people find it interesting that you make it relevant to their life. So I put some nice things in there and in the footnotes, for example. So from my own experience, alhamdulillah, the youth, they like it, the translation, and they find it accessible and enjoyable. Allahu Akbar. Khalas, barakallahu feekum, jazakallahu khairan. Translation is here, you check it out. Barakallahu feekum.